the philosophers, you know, when they speak about the first cause or the first intellect, this is similar. They read these concepts and they brought it to apply it in Islam. Such concept is similar to the philosophical concept of that called first Ula, or the first active intellect from whom the creation emanated. This is the concept of emanation, the philosophical concept of what? Emanation. Right. Second thing related to Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. So this is the first thing. Some of them believe that Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم represents the first designation of the that, of the essence of Allah. And from Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم came the entire creation, and he himself, Muhammad, is the God on the throne. This is the top extreme. The second, some Sufis hold to the same concept that we just mentioned, about, and just we mentioned, but they do not say that the essence of Muhammad is above the Arsh. They don't say that the essence of Muhammad is what? Is above the Arsh. But rather they say that from him came the entire creation, as mentioned earlier. Third, many Sufis claim that the light of Muhammad, Nur Muhammad, the light of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, is the first being. Is the first being. And that he صلى الله عليه وسلم is the most honorable of creation. And for his sake, look at that. And for Muhammad's sake, Allah has created the universe. Had it not been for Muhammad, Allah would have not created the universe. The entire universe is created for the sake of whom? Muhammad. And this is even common on the tongue of common Muslims and who are affected by the Sufis. لَوْلَاكَ مَا خَلَقَ الْأَفْلَاكَ. Had it not been for you, he would not have created all these spheres. Isn't it? Didn't you hear such a thing? This is all that goes back to the first concept. But it's coming mild. They don't want to say Muhammad himself, they're saying the light of Muhammad. You see, this is the catch. Light of Muhammad. But if you dig deep into the secret, you find that they mean that Muhammad himself. Not just his light. To say that these are moderate Sufis. Yeah? They don't, you see, because if you come to the common Muslims, you know, they cannot really go deep and tell them right away. You know what it's all about. They have to take them gradually into the esoteric and the mystic ways. They don't explicitly say that the creatures originated from Muhammad. This is the third group. I want to give you some names so that you remember when you, if you come across, you hit the red light. You know, you flash the red light. You can find many of the Sufi concepts regarding Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم in sayings, writings, and invocations of principal Sufis like Abu Talib al-Makki, al-Ghazali, Ibn Arabi, al-Jimi, Ibn Mashish, or sometimes said Ibn Bashish. Abu al-Hasan al-Shazi, belongs to the al-Shazili Tariqah. It's famous in Egypt, in Syria, and many places. Abu al-Hasan al-Shazi, al-Busiri. Al-Busiri, the one who wrote their infamous poem, Nahj al-Burda. Nahj al-Burda. This is something, you know, singers sing. Something memorized by many common Muslims who don't really know what it is. In it, there is explicit shirk, elevating Muhammad to the level of divinity, that he knows what's written in al-Lawh al-Mahfuz. In the preserved tablet. We mentioned Al-Busiri in Nahj al-Burda, Ahmed Badawi. You know, Badawi has a grave in Egypt. 2 million people circulate around the grave every year in the city of Tanta in Egypt. They make pilgrimage to that, the grave of Badawi. Al-Jazuli, and in his book Dala'il al-Khairat. This Dala'il al-Khairat, is you can find it in many, many mosques even. This book Dala'il al-Khairat is called Book of Dhikr. And in it, there is a lot of shirk. Ahmed al-Rifa'i, to whom belongs, people attribute al-Tariqa al-Rifa'iyya. Al-Tariqa al-Rifa'iyya. Ibrahim al-Dassouqi, Fakhruddin al-Razi, Muhammad al-Bakri, al-Salah al-Bakriya, invocations. Another, some invocations stressing such concepts that we mentioned include التيجانية, الجيلانية, الثقافية, الإدريسية, and others as well. You find in their books what we have mentioned regarding Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he is the light, you know, from whom. Concurred that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the essence of emanation of all knowledge. From him came al-fayd, which they refer to as al-fayd al-sufi, the Sufi emanation. Some of them consider that this emanation is eternal, meaning that it is present even before the existence of Muhammad. That's why a large sector of the Sufis believe that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knows al-ghayb. Knows al-ghayb. Rarely you find a Sufi who doesn't believe this. Rarely. That Muhammad knows of al-ghayb. And that nothing escapes his knowledge in the heavens and on the earth. They have also innovated many practices aimed at showing their so-called love of the Prophet ﷺ, including celebrations of the Prophet's birthday and his journey of Isra and Mi'raj and his Hadra and so forth. You know the Sufi Hadra? When they sit circling in a circle and they say we're going to make dhikr, their Sufi innovated way of dhikr, they start doing this dhikr and repeating the name of Allah so many 100 times or 1,000 times, and then they circulate and move their bodies right and left, take their hands and, you know, go in circles and turning their heads also left and right, back and forth, you name it. And then they say, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam now comes. And he sits and he attends the circle. This is called Al-Hadra al-Muhammadiyya. And so forth. They even call upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam seeking aid and help, believing that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam responds and answers such shirk after his death. Such concepts, beliefs and practices concerning Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are corrupt and contradict the message of the Quran and Sunnah, as well as the way of the true believers of the Sahaba and those who follow them on the path of righteousness. May Allah be pleased with them all. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard the ummah from such innovations and from such bid'ah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lift up high the da'wah of the salaf and makes it prevail sallallahu subhanahu wa ta'ala in the lands and meaning on the earth. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give aid and support to the sincere Muslims who adhere to this da'wah of da'wah as-salaf as-salih rahimahumullah radiyallahu anhum ajma'in wa ja'ala Allah wa iyyakum minhum. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes us amongst them who hold to their beliefs and who inshallah will die in that. Ameen. Subhanakallah wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Of course the list continues, but I wanted to stress on the two main things which are related to la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. So understand them, the concept of Tawheed, the right concept of Tawheed, and we could consider what opposes it, and we took also the meaning of Muhammad Rasulullah and what it really means, and we took some of the things which oppose it through the study of this innovative ways of Sufism. Muhammad al-Ghazali advocated Sufism strongly, and the people on Wahdat, نعم من أحياء العلوم and others, من أحياء العلوم and others, other books, many other books, and the people Ibn Arabi and others built up on the thoughts of Al-Ghazali. They built up on his thoughts, but at the end of his life Al-Ghazali concentrated on Hadith, and he died while he was studying Hadith. So there inshallah, maybe it was inshallah a good sign. نعم inshallah, that's what inshallah we believe. But having said that, his books are there. So you don't go and go study his books. Yeah. So it's important to remember that. Now. Yes. Now. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. Now. Paul, enough, it's because of him everything was created. He's, and by him all things exist, subhanallah. And that's why, you know, you read, you know, the thoughts of these people and the concepts, as we said earlier, very similar. There is a great deal of